Thank you, Dick. Thank you for that introduction, and welcome to all of you. And this is the fourth event this year that we've sold out. We had two lectures on Flannery O'Connor that sold out, John O'Malley talking about Vatican II, and the Synod on the Family that sold out, and now John Allen talking about Pope Francis. And having heard John a little bit at our board meeting before this event, I can tell you you're in for a real treat. Of all the reporters who cover the Vatican from the United States, John is considered the premier reporter. You know this because he has titles like senior analyst on religion at CNN, and he also told me he's not only the senior but also the junior analyst. It's like I'm the executive director, or the director, or whatever. So we all have some titles, but more important than the titles is what John has done. He's written for many, many years as a journalist. He knows all the inside players. He's been on the plane many times with the current Pope. He knows how to discover and uncover the insides of how the papacy, the Vatican, the Catholic Church work. And it's a real pleasure for me because I actually use John's book, The Catholic Church, which I commend to you with all his books, which gives you a very nice, concise understanding of the Catholic Church. So if you ever want to figure like you could use a refresher, whatever, or it's your first time sort of looking at the Catholic Church, I couldn't commend a better book for you. He is currently the associate editor of Religion, correct?
Catholic Church.
I keep getting that wrong. The Catholic Church at the Boston Globe. He's also the editor of a wonderful website called Crux Now, C-R-U-X Now. I also commend that to you. If you want to get sort of a daily or weekly update on what's going on in the church, what's Pope Francis doing, what are the cardinals doing, what is happening in different parts of the world, in very readable and interesting prose, I commend that to you. So without further ado, let me introduce the speaker for tonight. It's my great pleasure to introduce John Allen Jr.
Hello, Atlanta.
Hello.
Now, listen, I know it is sort of pro forma in situations like this for a speaker to start by saying how delighted they are to be wherever it is they are. And a lot of the time, to be honest with you, that's kind of empty rhetoric. I mean, if you spend a lot of time in the lecture circuit, the truth of it is, most days you wake up not even quite sure what city you're in, you know, let alone whether you're thrilled to be there. But I can tell you, I actually am thrilled to be here tonight, and I can prove that to you in three ways. One, it is a delight to be in Atlanta, and let me tell you why. I spend a great deal, an astonishing deal, a shameful deal of my adult life in Atlanta, but almost all of it is in your airport. I am a Diamond Medallion 360 million miler, you know, whatever the ultimate high tier in the Delta system is. You all know the joke, I'm sure, that on Delta, if you die on a Delta flight, you may go to heaven, you may go to hell, but either way, you have to connect through Atlanta. And I can tell you from personal experience, this is certainly true. I know every inch of that airport. I know where all the smoking lounges are. I know where all the sky clubs are. I've always had this kind of gut level instinct that there's got to be a city out there someplace, okay, beyond this airport, but I've never actually really had an opportunity to experience it before. So thank you for that opportunity, and thank you for proving to me that this thing about Southern hospitality is not a myth, because I have never been made to feel more welcome or had a more gracious embrace than I have had with you here tonight. So thank you for that. Second reason I'm thrilled to be here is that I am a big fan of your Archbishop, Wilton Gregory, who I got to know back when he was Bishop Gregory, when he was president of the Bishops' Conference in 2002-2003, which you may remember was the white hot period of the child sexual abuse scandals in the Catholic Church in the United States. Ladies and gentlemen, if the moment ever comes when we launch a beatification or canonization process for Wilton Gregory, I will volunteer to give testimony for the positio. Okay, that's the document that the Vatican has to compile. Because I think his performance during that time was nothing short of miraculous. He provided a face and a voice for the leadership of the Catholic Church in this country that exuded compassion,
that it exuded concern, and that perhaps more importantly than anything else, that exuded competence. In short, ladies and gentlemen, the U.S. bishops won the lottery by having him as their president during that span of time. He will never again have to do anything else, at least in my view, to prove himself as a treasure and an enormous asset for the Catholic Church in the United States. And finally, I am glad to be here because it brings me to the Aquinas Center, which means that it brings me into the company of Dominicans. And folks, I have been an enormous fan and admirer of the Dominicans over the years. You know, it is sometimes said, I think perhaps just slightly fancifully, but it is sometimes said that the Dominicans are the lone major religious order in the Catholic Church that did not experience a crisis after the Second Vatican Council, did not go through one of these kind of identity crises that many of the orders did. And I say that's somewhat fanciful because those Dominicans who have been around a while will tell you that there were moments of tumult and difficulty along the way. But there is some truth to it. Because there is a kind of genetic setting for balance inside the Dominican order. They never lean too far in one direction. They don't allow themselves to become captive to the latest fad or the latest ideological current. They are deeply grounded in the tradition of the church, but they are also always alive to the new possibilities that any moment in the life of the church may present. Now, in my own moderate, kind of minor fashion, that commitment to balance, that commitment to integration of the past and the present and the future has also been what I've tried to be about as a journalist for 20 years. I guess what I'm saying, guys, in some ways I feel myself a kind of honorary Dominican. And so if you hear nothing else from me tonight, I hope you will hear this. It is from the bottom of my heart. It's addressed in the first instance to the Dominicans in the room, but also to all of you who in various ways take part in their ministry. A very simple two-word message. These are true words I suspect you do not hear nearly often enough, so I want you to hear them from me tonight. And those two words are, thank you. Thank you for who you are and for what you do. Your order and what it gives rise to, including the Aquinas Center here at Emory, these are precious gifts to the church. They are part of the crown jewels of Catholicism. We will never, as Catholics, be able to repay the debt we owe to the Dominican Order, but at the very least, we can begin by saying clearly, loudly, and unambiguously that we respect, value, and venerate what you're about and what you do for us. So to the Dominicans everywhere, thank you. By the way, for those of you who do a lot of public speaking, I really recommend this to you as a rhetorical strategy. Always start by flattering your hosts. If you do that, you can usually get away with murder, right? And we're going to test that theory, okay, by jumping into the meat of tonight's presentation. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I've been asked to speak to you about the Pope, and specifically the title I've been given, the task that's been put for me here tonight, is to answer a question. And the question is Pope Francis a reformer? Is he a global missionary? Is he a servant leader? Just so there's no drama about where we're going, let me be clear. The correct answer to that question is he is all of the above. However, that all of the above has to be understood properly. Okay? That is, it's one thing to call him a reformer. It's another thing to know what does he mean by reform. It's one thing to call him a missionary. It's another thing to ask what is his concept of mission. And it's one thing to call him a servant leader, and it's another to ask, what does that mean to him in practice? And that's what we're going to try to do here tonight by unpacking what I would consider to be the kind of three pillars of the Francis papacy. But before we get to that, I want to begin with a kind of general observation that will serve as a springboard. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm conscious tonight that I speak in a distinguished line of intellectuals and academics who have occupied this space before me. I am sorry to tell you that I am neither an intellectual nor an academic, so I'm going to be lowering the tone a bit here tonight. I am instead a journalist. And if you have a right to expect nothing else of journalists, you at least have a right to expect this. You have the right to expect that we will get our facts right. So let us begin tonight with a fact about Pope Francis. Not a hunch, not a theory, not an anecdotal impression, but a hardcore, take it to the bank, 100% empirical certainty about this Pope. And that fact is the following. Pope Francis right now is the most popular religious leader on the face of the planet and one of the most popular figures of any sort. Now, I could illustrate that to you in a variety of different ways. For example, we could talk about the Pope's Twitter following. Do you all know that the Pope just broke the 15 million mark in terms of his following on Twitter? That makes him by far the most followed spiritual point of reference, though not yet the most followed person on Twitter. Do you all know who that is, by the way, the single most followed human being on Twitter? Shout it out. What do you think? Justin Bieber is a good guess, but Matt, not quite right. The correct answer, I think I caught it from this corner of the room. Lady Gaga. Exactly. And yes, ladies and gentlemen, surely the apocalypse cannot be far behind. But, you know, give the Pope a break. He's only been on Twitter 2 years. 15 million is not bad. Okay. Or we could talk about his poll numbers. Okay, again, it is a fact, not a hunch, a theory, a gut-level impression. It is a fact, measurable, that in every corner of the world in which public opinion can be scientifically assessed, this Pope has approval ratings that politicians and celebrities would sacrifice their children to pagan gods to obtain. Okay, for example, the most recent USA Today Gallup CNN poll found that in the United States, Pope Francis overall, among Americans generally, has an approval rating of about 89%. And among Catholics in the United States, he has approval rating of around 92-93%. Now, 92-93%, okay? Now, sit with that number for a minute, okay? And put it in juxtaposition with what all of us in this room know about how badly divided the Catholic Church in the United States is over virtually everything. Okay, and the truth of it is, under ordinary circumstances, it would be tough to get 93% of American Catholics to agree that today is Monday. Okay? I mean, there would be at least 20% who would say, who are you to impose your sense of time on us? Right? In that context, okay, the fact that this Pope has a 93% approval rating is nothing short of flabbergasting, and frankly, if we ever get around to beatifying him, I think it could count as his first miracle. Okay, it's that. And yes, if there's a canon lawyer in the room, I am aware that the miracles and sainthood causes have to come after the death, but give me a break. This is for purposes of illustration. All right? But none of that sort of quantitative measure is what I want to give you to illustrate the electricity around this figure. Instead, what I'd like to do is tell you a story. Now, this Pope comes from Pope Francis's first overseas trip. It's when he went to Brazil in July of 2013 for World Youth Day. That's the kind of, you know, major gathering of Catholic youth from around the world that the church sponsors every 2 or 3 years. It was launched under John Paul II, and it has now become a routine part of the church's activity. The Pope inherited that trip from Pope Benedict. Okay, but immediately confirmed his intention to go. That trip culminated, by the way, when Pope Francis celebrated both the concluding Saturday night youth vigil and also the Sunday morning final mass, celebrated both of those events on Rio's Copacabana beach, right? That iconic stretch of sand and surf. Okay, on both of those occasions, he drew crowds in excess of 3 million people. Ladies and gentlemen, shattering the previous attendance record at Copacabana, which had been held by, wait for it, the Rolling Stones. Okay? I mean, this is how you know you've arrived, okay, as a pop culture phenomenon. But that's not even the story I want to tell. The story I want to tell actually comes from earlier in World Youth Day week. It was Tuesday. The Holy Father decided he wanted to make a trip to Aparecida, which is the most important Marian sanctuary, kind of pilgrimage destination in Brazil. Second most popular Marian shrine anywhere in Latin America after Guadalupe. And Our Lady of Aparecida is kind of the national patroness of Brazil. Pope Francis, as a good Latin American pastor, has an enormous devotion to the Blessed Mother. He wanted to go to that shrine to consecrate his entire papacy to the Blessed Mother. Now, Aparecida is about 70 kilometers outside of Rio, which is where the Pope was spending most of his time. All the way along the highway, okay, Brazilians were lined up 3, 4, 5, 6 deep, okay, which is a massive turnout of humanity. And when we got to Aparecida, it was another mob scene. There was maybe 500,000 people there. But I was in the press bus, so I was behind the Pope Mobile. So when we pulled in around the Basilica, okay, this was in an area that was supposed to be a secure zone, right? It was supposed to be cordoned off, so the crowds were not supposed to be there. All right? However, there was this group of Latin American nuns that somehow had wormed their way into this space. Okay, so when the door to the Popemobile pops open and he steps out, they start shrieking like teenage girls at a Justin Bieber concert. Okay, they rush in. Okay, they're hugging him. They're giving him wet, sloppy kisses. He's standing there taking selfies with them. Okay, it's complete madness. Now, you have to understand, the Brazilians had set aside like 20,000 security personnel to prevent exactly this kind of insanity from happening. And there was a whole phalanx of troops standing there, okay, just watching all of this go on. So I pulled one of these guys aside and I said, hey, you know, what's going on? Why aren't you doing something? And he looked at me, this kid couldn't have been more than 21 or 22. He looked at me and he said, look at me, man. I've got a combat helmet on my head. I've got ammo strapped across my chest. I am not going to be the guy caught on YouTube beating up a nun. It's just not going to happen. Now, this kid, I think, without trying, had stumbled across an insight, a core insight into the popular appeal of Pope Francis, which is there is a ferment around this figure, an electricity around him, that is so strong that any attempt to fence it in or to bottle it up is destined to fail. And therefore, in ordinary circumstances, the better strategy is simply not to try. Okay? Now look, it is fun to catalog all the ways in which the Pope has kind of become a pop star, right? I mean, we didn't even talk about all the magazine covers he's been on, right? Including, by the way, Rolling Stone magazine. And yes, ladies and gentlemen, I did buy 5 copies for my mother. I know I'm dating myself with that reference, but for those of you who got the Dr. Hook and the Medicine Band, shout out, thank you. But obviously, the substantive question underneath all of that, okay, is what is the apostolic and missionary cash value of that appeal? That is, you know, it obviously, certainly from Francis's point of view, and I would dare submit from all of ours, we should not be content simply with the Pope being a celebrity. We should ask ourselves the question, what missionary use, what apostolic use, what evangelical use are we going to make of the cachet and the appeal and the popularity that this Pope has amassed? Okay. Now, tough question to answer. Just bear in mind, have that in your heads, that is sort of the $64,000 question to be asked about Pope Francis's appeal. Is this going to be a moment in which the fascination with the Pope translates into the new evangelization on behalf of the church, or is it going to become ephemeral? And is it going to pass away like so many other pop culture phenomena rise and fall without really leaving a dent on their times? Okay. It's a question we have to ask. What I want to do now is try to explain to you what I think lies underneath the fascination that Francis has elicited. In other words, substantively speaking, what is it about this figure that the outside world has found so compelling, so fascinating? What has caused media organizations around the world to elevate Francis into basically occupying the status in the media landscape of being the new Nelson Mandela, that is the new unquestioned source of moral authority on the global stage? What is it about the man that has provided that kind of entree into sectors of opinion and sectors of interest in which, quite honestly, the Catholic Church traditionally is not often rated particularly high? Okay. And what I want to suggest to you is that perhaps without being able to name it, the outside world has clued into the pillars of this Pope's agenda, that is the kind of core principles of his vision that animate what he does and that, that underlie the specific policy decisions and declarations that he makes and so forth and so on. What I want to suggest to you is that there are 3 such pillars with regard to Pope Francis. And then if you get your minds and your hands around these 3 points, you will be in a very good position to separate the wheat from the chaff, to cut through the noise about this Pope and understand what is actually going on and where he's actually trying to take the church in his times. So let me briefly tick off those 3 pillars for you, and then I'll unpack each. The 3 pillars are, 1, leadership as service. Leadership as service. 2, a deeply missionary conception of church. A deeply missionary conception of church. And 3, mercy as the core Christian message for this moment in time. mercy as the core gospel principle to be lifted up in this age. Okay? Let's begin with leadership as service. In the early days after Francis's election 2 years ago, and by the early days I mean the first 48, 72, 96 hours after he was elected, it was, of course, those kind of gestures of personal humility and simplicity that sort of captured the imagination of the world, right? You all remember. I mean, the fact that after the conclave ended, okay, and the cardinals were leaving the Sistine Chapel, rather than getting into the chauffeur-driven Mercedes papal limo, he hopped onto the shuttle bus with the other cardinals like one of the fellas. Okay, the fact that the day after his election, he went back to the Casa del Clero, that's the kind of hotel for clergy in Rome he had been staying at before the conclave started, in order to pack his own bag and pay his own bill. Okay, the fact that famously, rather than living in the papal apartments, he decided to remain in room 201 of the Doma Santa Marta, that's the residence on Vatican grounds where the cardinals had been staying during the conclave. Or, listen, I mean, for that matter, the fact that the day after his election, he picked up the phone and called his newspaper delivery guy in Buenos Aires to say, hey, I'm not going to be coming back. Can you please cancel my subscription? And by the way, if I am Mario Poli, the new Archbishop of Buenos Aires, I'm a little ticked off about that because now I got to restart the paper and it's kind of a pain in the neck. But symbolically, it was brilliant. All right, now listen, I mean, to some extent, all of that simply arose naturally from the personality of Jorge Mario Bergoglio. Those gestures simply are who this man is. I mean, famously, during the 15 years he was the Archbishop of Buenos Aires, he did not live in the Archbishop's palace, but instead he chose to live in a Spartan apartment downtown near one of the Villas Miserias, the Villas of Miseries, the slums, where he wanted to be present. And when I say, by the way, this was a Spartan apartment, ladies and gentlemen, I am not trafficking in euphemisms. I visited this place. Okay, it was the kind of apartment where he had to leave the stove on in the kitchen 24/7 during the winter because the building could not afford central heat. Okay, that's where he chose to live while he was ministering to the city as archbishop. So what I'm saying is that these gestures in the early days, these were not faux public relations exercises. Okay, they were insights into the man. Now, that said, if you want a five-star banner headline, dare not forget about it, insight into the personality of Pope Francis, okay, something that you need to grasp in full living color to truly appreciate who the man is and what he's about, here it is, folks, with no ifs, ands, and buts. The insight is this. Beneath that humble, simple exterior lies the mind of a brilliant Jesuit politician. Okay. This is a pope who knows what he is doing all of the time. There are no accidents. There are no coincidences. He's not stumbling or lurching from one situation to the next. He has a game plan. Now, whether that game plan works is another conversation, but he always has a game plan. Okay. So what was the game plan behind allowing the world in on the secret? Okay, in those early days? And I would submit to you the game plan was that Pope Francis is trying to engineer a Copernican shift in perceptions of leadership in the Catholic Church. What he wants is that when the world looks at the symbol of authority in Catholicism, when they look at the Roman collars that priests wear, when they look at the pectoral crosses that bishops wear, he wants them to think automatically not in terms of power and privilege, but in terms of service. Terms of service. And fortunately, this is not a journalistic hypothesis. I mean, the Pope has laid all this out for us in black and white. One of the early things he did in June of 2013, shortly after his election, is that he asked all of the nuncios of the world, those are the papal ambassadors in the various countries who are responsible for selecting new bishops, he asked them all to come to Rome for a meeting. And on that occasion, he laid out in great detail his vision of the kind of leadership he wants them to be looking for. And what he said on that occasion is that what we do not want, and this is his language, he said, what we do not want are leaders with the psychology of a prince. So that's what we're not looking for. Instead, he said, what I want you to be looking for, and again, this is his language, pastors who carry the smell of their sheep. because they are close to the ordinary people they are called to serve. Pastors who care carry the smell of their sheep. So that's this Pope's vision. And we also now know, by the way, ladies and gentlemen, that this is not simply rhetoric. We also know that the Pope was willing to take action to make it stick. And the proof of the point comes to us courtesy of the Diocese of Limburg in Germany. This is the famous story of the bling bishop. You all know this story? This is Bishop Franz Peter Tabarts von Elst. I mean, just sit with that name for a minute. Franz Peter Tabarts von Elst. I mean, the name just reeks of, like, aristocracy, right? Which is actually too bad, because the poor bishop comes from a family of impoverished farmers. But I guarantee you, the name did not help as this played out. This is the story of the bishop who got into hot water when it was revealed that he had spent more than $40 million remodeling his private residence, including, if you look at the final tab, more than $1 million for gardening and landscaping. And in my opinion, the most kind of surprising element of the whole thing, $35,000 on a bathtub. Now, I don't really know what kind of bathtub you can buy for $35,000. When this story broke, I hit a couple Home Depots, and I could not find one. But, you know, apparently they exist, and His Excellency had come up with one. When this story first began to make the rounds, the Holy Father dispatched an investigator to the Diocese of Limburg. He sent a heavy hitter, a Vatican Cardinal Italian by the name of Giovanni Laiolo, who had been the Vatican's foreign minister, to ascertain that the facts of the situation were correct as they had been reported. He then brought both the bishop and the president of the German Bishops' Conference to Rome for consultations. And ladies and gentlemen, just as an insight to corporate culture, if you don't already have it, no matter what line of work you're in, if you're summoned to the home office for consultations, that's never good news. And on the back of that, the Pope decided to give this bishop an unspecified period of sabbatical outside the diocese, and the story kind of reached its denouement a year ago, last February, when he accepted the bishop's resignation. By the way, the remodeled facility in Limburg is, going forward, no longer going to be the bishop's residence, but it's going to be a center for the poor in that diocese. Now, listen, you know, for those with eyes to see and ears to hear, in Catholic circles, this was kind of the shot heard around the world, because what it said is that this commitment to leadership as service isn't just talk, and it's not just rhetoric, but it's an actual expectation of the Holy Father that, at least in certain circumstances, he is willing to take administrative action to back up. And I think most of the other prelates of the Catholic world kind of got the memo. Now listen, up to this point, we have been talking about bishops largely because they are our most visible leaders. But I think in Francis's mind, this business about leadership as service applies much more broadly than simply the episcopacy. I think it applies to anyone who exercises leadership on behalf of the church. So it applies to principals of Catholic schools. It applies to the CEOs of Catholic hospitals. It applies to members of parish council committees in Catholic parishes, and local pastors, and on and on. And I think the point simply is this, that he wants to make it clear that in the outside world, leadership may be about amassing, consolidating, maintaining, and exercising power, but it must not be that way in the church. Now, to date, his success in engineering that Copernican revolution is, of course, a mixed bag. But that clearly is this Pope's agenda, and I think it is the first pillar of what he's trying to achieve for the church in his time, a redefinition of leadership in a spirit of service, not in a spirit of power. Secondly, mission. Ladies and gentlemen, by this stage in my career, I have covered three popes. I covered John Paul II, I covered Benedict XVI, I am now covering Pope Francis. Been doing this for 20 years, man and boy, day in and day out. If you want one conclusion I have drawn on the back of that experience that I regard as utterly beyond any reasonable debate, okay, lots of things about the life of the church you can have a conversation about, but if you want something about the papacy in the early 21st century that I consider to be absolutely empirically true, it is that being pope is an impossible job. It's an impossible job. And I don't mean how the papacy is defined in the code of canon law or in our theology. But I mean out in the street. What are the popular expectations of popes? We expect, well, think about what people expect popes to be. We expect them to be intellectual giants. Okay, with something to say about every development in the culture. We expect them to be master politicians and statesmen with something artful and incisive to do about every global crisis the moment it blows up. We expect them to be media rock stars. We expect them to be the CEO of a Fortune 500 religious multinational. And of course, we expect them to be living saints. Now, any one of those things is extremely difficult to do, okay, as a life's work. To do well, you roll them all up into one ball, it is a prescription for perpetual heartburn. Okay? If you want proof of the toll that the papacy takes on a man, I would suggest you do what I did back in 2005 when we were in the twilight of the John Paul years. Go back and watch the film from 1978 of this young cardinal from Poland, Karol Wojtyła, elected at the age of 58, who bound onto the world stage and took it by storm, this swashbuckling man's man, this John Wayne of a pope, okay, who grabbed the world by the scruff of its neck and forced it to pay attention. And compare that to that bent, broken, and frail figure we saw in April 2005 when the end was near. On Palm Sunday in 2005, that pope, who was rolled up to the window of his bedroom overlooking St. Peter's Square, and for an agonizing 12 minutes and 47 seconds tried to speak to the crowd in the square below and could not summon even a single word. And in so doing, probably delivered the most eloquent testimony of his entire papacy, because what that day said about his persistence and his fidelity and his love for the people who turned out to see him, unrivaled. Now, the difference between the John Paul of 1978 and John Paul of 2005 wasn't simply the age. The man was only 83 when he died. And it wasn't simply the Parkinson's disease. It was also the toll of the office. It is a bone-crushing burden which he carried for almost 27 years. Now, the takeaway for me from all of this is that it is impossible to perform every aspect of the papacy. It is impossible to meet every expectation that people have of popes perfectly. Inevitably, every pope has to pick and choose where they're going to invest their time and their treasure. Okay? Oh, with John Paul in the early stages of his papacy, his investment was in the political and moral capital of the papacy, in the transformation of Europe, and his role in the collapse of communism speaks to his success. Benedict was obviously a teaching pope. He was interested in the engagement of culture, and in many other aspects of the papacy were not as compelling to him. Now, with Francis, I guarantee you, ladies and gentlemen, that when Francis gets out of bed in the morning, he does not, in the first instance, think of himself as an administrator or a manager, even though he knows he was elected to reform the inner workings of the Vatican, and management reform has been an important element of his agenda. Similarly, he does not get out of bed in the morning thinking of himself in the first place as a statesman or a politician, even though engaging the issues of the day has also been an important element on his to-do list. His role, for example, in restoring diplomatic relations between the United States and Cuba speak to his efficacy in doing that. Fundamentally, however, I can guarantee you that when Francis gets up in the morning, he sees himself in the first place, at the end of the day, he sees himself as a missionary. Okay? He wants to be the missionary in chief of the Catholic Church. And his fundamental ambition is to relight the missionary fires of the church in his time. His stock phrase, something he says so often that it probably ought to be in his business cards, okay, is that he wants the church to get out of the sacristy and into the streets. Okay, out of the sacristy, into the streets, making the faith relevant to real people in the concrete circumstances of their daily lives. It is fundamentally a missionary ambition. And I think, as Pope Francis sees it, the sense of mission with which he is imbued has both an individual and a social component. Let's talk about the individual first. Here's a mistake that I think those of us in Catholic circles sometimes make when we talk about mission. And I think it is we Americans are particularly susceptible to this. Okay? Because when we Americans, and you, some of you may have had this experience, you get in a room, you know, with fellow Catholics, and you want to talk about what does it mean to be a missionary church. What do we instinctively think in terms of? We think in terms of projects and systems and action plans, right? We want to build a better mousetrap okay, you know, and turn it loose on the world. And what that sometimes comes at the expense of is acknowledging the real flesh and blood human beings who are in front of us right now, today, who are our opportunities to do mission today. Being present to the real people right now, who, to whom you have an opportunity to offer a taste of God's love, God's compassion, and God's eternal and never-ending desire for their salvation. Okay. So, when you see Pope Francis doing things like stopping his Popemobile in the middle of St. Peter's Square and hopping off because out of the corner of his eye, he has caught sight of a guy named Vincenzo Riva, who has a genetic skin disorder that has left him horribly covered in boils. Okay, the kind of guy that most of us would cross the street to avoid running into because we'd be embarrassed, we wouldn't know what to say. When you see the Pope hopping off the Popemobile to run over to that guy and wrap him in a warm, loving him embrace and then giving him a kiss on the top of his head, which, by the way, Riva later said, after he got over weeping nonstop for days, Riva later said that had restored his faith, that he had given up on the church because he felt that it no longer cared about him, it wasn't interested in him. It was that moment, that chance encounter with the Pope in the square, that it restored him to the practice of the faith. Listen, again, part of that is just Francis being Francis. But again, remember the brilliant Jesuit politician. It was also designed to demonstrate what individual mission looks like in action, attentiveness to the people in your immediate environment who need you to be their missionary today. Or when you see Francis inviting a 16-year-old Italian teenager with Down syndrome to hop up onto the Popemobile to join him for a couple of swings through the square. That's individual mission in action. When you see Francis inviting three homeless guys to his birthday breakfast, by the way, footnote, it wasn't just the homeless guys, it was also their dog, whose name is Marley, for the reggae icon Bob Marley. Now, ladies and gentlemen, Pope Francis is a pope of firsts in many respects. I guarantee you this is one of them, because I can promise you on my mother's grave, this was the first time the name Bob Marley had ever been uttered in the precincts of the Vatican. And by the way, I asked one of these guys later, did the Pope know who Bob Marley was? And they said no, but when we explained it to him, he thought it was cool. All right. Again, that's not just showy PR gestures. That's intended to drive home what individual mission looks like. Okay, being aware of the people who are in your immediate environment and making sure that no system, no action plan, no, you know, white paper makes you so rigidly inflexible that you can't adjust whatever you're doing to be attentive and present to those people in the here and now. Now, that said, there clearly is a social dimension to this Pope's sense of mission as well. And here I would like to say a brief word, because I think this Pope's social agenda has to some extent been misunderstood or perhaps misconstrued. You know, one of the things that has made Francis such a sensation, as you all know, is that he makes himself available to the media. In a way that previous popes simply have not done. And the first time he did this was on route back from Brazil to Rome at the end of World Youth Day in July 2013. Totally spontaneously, Francis came to the back of the papal plane and basically said to those of us who were there, walked back and said, all right, turn on the microphone, and then what do you got? Okay, and for an hour and 20 minutes, we engage in this no holds barred, no filters, no taboos, no limits whatsoever, you know, every topic under the sun, you know, being able to ask the Pope anything you ever wanted. Now, folks, you need to know that when you cover the Vatican for 20 years, in the dead of night, in the dark, okay, when you're lying awake in the wee hours, you dream of these moments. You don't actually think you're ever going to live to see them happen, okay? But there it was. I mean, I sometimes jokingly say that Alitalia Flight 4001 from Rio de Janeiro to Rome in July 2013 was in most respects nothing to write home about. The seats were uncomfortable, the food was mediocre, but ladies and gentlemen, I will give it this, the in-flight entertainment was spectacular. Okay, because that's what we got. And on that occasion, and in a number of other of his early media interviews, the Pope made some version of the following point. He said, I don't think it is necessary for me to talk so much about abortion and contraception and gay marriage, because the teaching of the church on those points is already well known. And in some quarters, particularly I think in the more committed pro-life quarters of the church, there was some concern that this pope was somehow backing away from the gospel of life or dialing down the church's defense of the sacredness of human life in the culture wars as we've come to know them. Ladies and gentlemen, I can assure you, nothing is farther from the truth. Take it from me, this is a robustly pro-life pope. Now, I could demonstrate that to you in a variety of different ways. For instance, I could mention that just days after we returned to Rome from that in-flight press conference, he had an audience with medical professionals in Italy in which he delivered one of the toughest pro-life speeches you will ever hear a pontiff give, arguing that the right to life is the primordial human right. It's the one upon which all the others are based. But my favorite illustration of the point is Pope Francis's trip to South Korea last August. As with Brazil, the Pope was given a schedule for this trip, and as with Brazil, he made one change to it, okay? Because he had been told that a social service center he was going to be visiting outside Seoul had a symbolic cemetery to the victims of abortion behind it on this kind of grass hilltop. Okay, South Korea, even though technically abortion is illegal, it actually has one of the highest abortion rates in the world. And he had heard that the Catholic community there had set up this memorial with hundreds of white crosses representing the victims of abortion underneath a statue of the Holy Family. And the Pope said that he wanted to go there. He wanted to visit it. And of course, he invited the TV cameras and the photographers with him because he knew that image would make the round of the world and it would, in a flash, make a statement about his commitment to the pro-life cause. So believe me, folks, there will be no retreat, there will be no surrender from the gospel of life and the defense of the sacredness of human life on this Pope's watch. Now, that said, I do believe that Francis, his calculation, is that there are other aspects of Catholic social teaching that have not always gotten a commensurate level of attention, okay, that he wants to lift up. And it's typically what we would refer to as the social gospel. Okay, so defense of the poor, critique of international economic structures, opposition to war, conflict resolution, defense of the environment, concern for immigrants, concern for race relations, that whole cluster of issues that we Catholics often talk about as social justice matters. That clearly is very much at the heart of this Pope's vision of what mission means in our time. Variety of different ways I could illustrate that to you, but here's my favorite. I've talked now a couple of times about the Pope's trip to Brazil. But do you know that was not actually his first trip outside of Rome as Pope? His first trip outside of Rome actually came earlier in the month of July in 2013 when the Holy Father chose to visit the southern Mediterranean island of Lampedusa. Now, Lampedusa is, for Europeans, basically what Nogales, Arizona is for Americans, okay? I mean, it's the primary point where immigrants, often illegal immigrants, are trying to cross the border. In this case, it's an island where these boats that they take across the Mediterranean will wash them up. They're dumped into detention centers, and then they apply for refugee or asylum status, and if they're lucky, if they win the lottery, then they try to move on up to Germany or Belgium or wherever it is they're trying to get in Europe. If they lose, of course, they're deported and they go back home. This crossing is so perilous because it's typically made in these overcrowded, rickety, unsafe, and illegal boats that over the last two decades alone, 20,000 people have died trying to make the way from Northern Africa or the Middle East over the Mediterranean to Lampedusa. 20,000 people. If you ever need an index of human misery, of the desperation to which circumstances will sometimes drive people, the fact that so many savvy, intelligent, world-aware folks made the choice not only to put themselves on these boats, but often to put their entire families on them, knowing full well that their children, their loved ones, might perish in the journey. I mean, it's a classic illustration of the inequities of the world in which we live. So Francis chose to make his first trip outside Rome, therefore his tone-setting debut as a traveler. He chose to make it there in Lampedusa. He laid a wreath in the sea to commemorate the 20,000 people who had died. He spent a couple of hours sitting in the detention centers listening to the stories of these migrants and refugees. And then he gave a talk in which he, for the first time, rolled out what has since become one of the rhetorical tropes of his papacy, which is this contrast between what he calls a throwaway culture, that is a culture in the 21st century world in which whole categories of people are just regarded as disposable, okay, against what he terms a culture of welcome or a culture of encounter that he believes the world is called to become and that the Catholic Church is called to model. Okay? None of this was an accident. Francis wanted his first programmatic journey as Pope to be making a statement about where the heart of the mission of the Church as he understood it in the here and now lies. And that is entirely what Lampedusa was about. Now, you know, we could offer dozens and dozens of other examples, but I don't think you're going to do any better than that in terms of an insight into what drives this Pope, in terms of his the kinds of mission that he wants the Church to be performing. And by the way, catch the point, not as an alternative to our engagement on behalf of the culture of life, but as an organic complement to it, and not as an alternative to the explicit invitation to faith in Jesus Christ, which is, of course, ultimately what mission is about, but as a necessary prelude to it. Okay? In other words, I believe his conviction is that the world will take us seriously as apostles of Christ if, in the first instance, they see us sincerely committed to the welfare of the most vulnerable, the most marginalized, the most forgotten, and the most abandoned in our environments. Okay, that's Francis in mission. Okay, and I believe that's the kind of motor fuel of his papacy, that sense that he wants everything that Catholicism does to be driven by that sense of mission. Finally, mercy as the core Christian message of this moment in time. Once again, as I said earlier, I've covered three popes, John Paul II, Benedict XVI, and Francis. I have had the great good fortune of being able to know all three of them personally, being able to see them do their thing. I know that they are all extraordinarily complex men, and it's simply impossible to sort of boil them down into handy-dandy little sound bites. That said, let me proceed to boil each man down into a handy-dandy little sound bite. Because there was, kind of with each pope, a sort of signature phrase that summed up a lot of what they were about. I mean, with John Paul II, there's no doubt what his signature phrase was. I mean, something he thundered over and over and over again every place he went. Be not afraid. Be not afraid. The Latin version of which was Duc in Altum, set off into the deep. You know, he was calling the Church to recapture its sense of adventure, its sense of possibility, you know? And with Benedict, again, I don't think there's any serious doubt about what that signature phrase was, something he said over and over and over again. The signature phrase was, and is, reason and faith. Reason and faith. That was the heart of the argument Benedict was trying to make to the world during 8 very difficult years as Pope. You know, that human reason and religious faith need each other. That human reason shorn of faith becomes skepticism and nihilism. That faith shorn of reason becomes fundamentalism and extremism. That to be healthy, these two things have to be in a relationship. I mean, if you'll pardon the egg-headed phrase, but it is Benedict we're talking about, you know, he would say they are symbiotically codependent. All right? So that was the heart of his message. Now, I know it's early in the game with Pope Francis, only 2 years in, but I think we already know what his signature phrase is destined to be, because it's something he just says over and over and over again. I mean, every talk he gives, there is some version of this line in it, everywhere he goes in the world. Okay? And the signature phrase, the catchphrase is, the Lord never tires of forgiving. The Lord never tires of forgiving. And sometimes he adds, it is we who get tired of asking for forgiveness. Fundamentally, ladies and gentlemen, it is a message of mercy. Mercy, folks, is quite literally this Pope's motto. Okay, his motto as Pope is the same motto he had as the Archbishop of Buenos Aires. It's a Latin phrase that it's kind of complicated to render into English. It's miserando atque elegendo. It comes from a homily of the Venerable Bede about the gospel scene of the call of Matthew. But fundamentally what it means is choosing through the eyes of mercy. Okay? Choosing through the eyes of mercy. I mean, I'm profoundly convinced if you did a textual study of everything Francis has said since his election, every word that has flowed out of his mouth, okay, you would find that by far the most common substantive noun he evokes is mercy. It was there in his first Sunday homily as Pope first Sunday Mass he had to celebrate, which he chose not to do in St. Peter's Basilica, but instead in St. Anne's Church in the Vatican, which is kind of the parish church of the worker bees in the Vatican, the people who do the cooking and the cleaning and open the mail and all of that. And he walked up to the ambo with no notes and said, "Listen, I hope the theologians in the room today will forgive me, but in my opinion, the strongest message of the Lord is mercy. Strongest message of the Lord is mercy." And this commitment to mercy, by the way, doesn't just run through the Pope's speech, it also runs through his deeds. One of the ways you can see this is his passionate commitment to the sacrament of confession, sacrament of reconciliation. I presume that many people in this room know that a Pope is also the Bishop of Rome, okay, meaning the leader of the local diocese in Rome. And popes try to take that seriously. So one of the things they try to do to live up to that aspect of the job description is they try to get around and visit Roman parishes. Okay, now Francis so far has visited 9, there are about 300 parishes in Rome. He has a way to go. He's made 9 of them so far. His first was on the 21st of May, 2013, when he went out to the parish of Saints Elizabeth and Zechariah in the Porta Pia neighborhood in Rome, which is kind of on the northern edge of the city, kind of a working class neighborhood. I was in Rome that day, so I went out for the visit, and I was in the office of the pastor, who's a Romanian immigrant by the name of Bioni Ambris. Everybody there calls him Father Ben. And the Pope was supposed to get there at 10:30, right? Like around 9:40, we start picking up the thump, thump, thump of a helicopter, okay, in the air. And our first thought is, well, no, this is the Italian Carabinieri, the Italian security services that are just doing like a flyover to make sure everything's copacetic. Right? But then the thump, thump, thump gets louder and louder, and eventually we realize, oh my God, this is the papal helicopter. He's coming like 45 minutes early. Okay? So after I had to run and get the defibrillator and get Father Ben's heart started again, he sprints out to this kind of makeshift helipad they had set up in the parking lot, right? And the papal chopper lands. It's 9:45. Okay, door opens, Francis pops out, and he says to Father Ben, "Listen, I'm sorry for the early start, but in addition to saying Mass and chatting with the folks and all of that, I would also really like to hear some confessions." Now, you gotta understand, this was not part of the program, so Father Ben ran and grabbed 8 people basically at random and said, "You are going to confession." It's actually cute. I was standing there, and one of them says to him, "But Father, I don't want to lose my spot in line to see the Pope." I was like, "Oh, trust me. You're going to see the Pope." Okay. So he brings these 8 people into the church, lines them up in front of the confessional. Francis comes in, you know, one by one. He listens to their sins, and they administers God's forgiveness. Now, again, in part, this was just him trying to be a good Bishop of Rome. But don't miss the point. The savvy Jesuit politician. It was important to him that the world see the Pope making a point out of celebrating the church's premier rite of mercy. I mean, this is a Pope, ladies and gentlemen, who has publicly described his papacy as a kairos of mercy. A kairos of mercy, using that evocative Greek New Testament term that means a privileged moment in God's plan of salvation. Okay, he understands his election to be a kind of providentially orchestrated moment in which the gospel of mercy can be lifted up and made resplendent for the world once again. Now listen, Jorge Mario Bergoglio, the man who is Pope Francis, he's no naive. Okay, he understands that as a minister of the Christian gospel, he is obligated to do 2 things with regard to a fallen world. He has to pronounce both God's mercy and also God's judgment. Okay, one without the other would be a falsification, a simplification of the Christian message. But I think his belief is that the world of late has heard our judgment with crystal clarity. And now it is time for the world to hear and to see and to smell and to feel and to taste our mercy. I'm 100% convinced, folks, that everything Francis is doing, from the nitty-gritty details of how do you reform the Vatican Bank, you know, all the way up to complicated pastoral choices about what do we do about divorced and remarried Catholics, and on, all of it, fundamentally, is predicated on the desire that when the outside world looks at the church, they will see a true community of mercy. community that doesn't simply pay lip service to mercy, but actually practices it in terms of its internal life. You know what my prediction? And I know no one in this room has asked for it, but ladies and gentlemen, I am infamous for answering questions I have never been asked. In my prediction, when the final word on this papacy is written, Francis will be remembered as the Pope of Mercy. Pope of Mercy. Okay. So, to recap, okay, the three elements of the Francis agenda are a commitment to leadership as service, not simply rhetorically, but operationally. A commitment to mission as the highest priority of the church, both in an individual and a social sense. And finally, mercy as the kind of calling card of that mission. Okay, the leading edge of the gospel that the world needs to hear in the here and now. Now, I think that, and I think people have sensed that about him, I think that explains a lot of the ferment around Pope Francis, but I'd like to take it one step further and suggest to you, this isn't simply a winning strategy for a papacy. It's a winning strategy for an evangelizing church. That is to say, ladies and gentlemen, let's tell one another some blunt truth. Blunt truth is this. Because of Pope Francis's popularity, right now the eyes of the world are on the Pope, and because the eyes of the world are on the Pope, they are also on us. Okay? Sectors of opinion in this world that tuned out the Catholic Church a long time ago suddenly are taking a new look. And it's not driven in the first instance by skepticism or hostility or crisis or scandal or controversy. It's generated by the fact we have a sympathetic figure at the top of the system. Now, question is, when the outside world looks at us, what are they going to see? I would submit to you that that is the $64,000 evangelical question to be asked. And as a reporter, a chronicler, I would tell you I can see two plausible trajectories for what people are going to see when they take a new look at the Catholic Church right now. One, they may see a community locked in internal combat and tribal warfare, arguing over the precise meaning of every last participle that flows out of the Pope's mouth. And that is a real and present possibility, ladies and gentlemen. I don't know if you know the old joke. There's an old joke, which I think actually comes out of the American South. It goes like this. There's a dad who's home one Sunday afternoon trying to watch an NFL game, okay? And his kids and some of their friends are upstairs in one of the bedrooms, okay, playing. And all of a sudden, the dad hears this commotion. He hears these kids screaming their lungs out at one another. Okay, you know, one kid is saying, "You're a complete idiot." The other kid, "No, you're absolutely wrong, and I can prove it," and blah, blah, blah. So he runs up the stairs to the bedroom, and he sees the kids on folding chairs in a circle just screaming their faces out at each other, and he asks them, "What in the world is going on here?" And one of the kids says, "Oh, don't worry, Dad. We're just playing church." Now, the joke stings a little bit, huh? But it stings because it captures an element of truth. I mean, sometimes church-going folk, religious people, precisely because we feel so passionate about our convictions, you know, allow ourselves to mimic the worst aspects of secular culture on the outside in terms of ideologizing things and partisan divisions and tribal rivalries and so on, right? That's one realistic prospect of what the world may see when they look at us now. Okay. Now, the other realistic possibility is that they may see a community that, despite its diversity, despite its differences, is genuinely making a good faith effort to kind of come together and to realize this mission statement that the Pope has given us for the church in our time of being the field hospital of humanity. Okay, the field hospital of humanity, that is the place where the wounds of a broken, bruised, and hurting world go to be cured. Now, I can't dictate this choice to you, but it certainly seems to me that the second option I just described is by far the more attractive missionary prospect. Okay, and if that's the face that Catholicism projects to the world in the here and now, and not because Francis told us to, and not because of his poll numbers, but because it is the evangelically right thing to do, then ladies and gentlemen, I would submit to you that is a winning strategy, not just for a papacy. That's a winning strategy for the life of the church in our time, every day of the week, and twice on Sunday. Okay. Thank you. God bless you. God bless the Aquinas Center. God bless the Dominicans.
Microphones. I feel like an airline steward.
Microphone.
Do you mind?
Over here. If you would like to ask a question, and surely there was something in there that provoked some thought.
And by the way, just to prime the pump here, very quickly, an invitation and a warning. The invitation is, ask anything you like about the presentation you just heard, but don't feel restricted to that if you've got some other curiosity. I may not know the answer to your question, but two decades in American TV has taught me that ignorance is never a bar to talking about anything. And I see no reason why it should get in our way here tonight. The warning is that the good people at the Aquinas Center are paying me to stand here for the next 15 minutes or so, whether you have questions or not. So if you don't come up with stuff to talk about, I am simply going to stand here and tell you more Pope jokes. And I guarantee you, this is not a consummation devoutly to be wished. Oh, don't believe me? All right, here's a sample. Pope walks into a bar with a frog on his shoulder. Bartender looks up and says, "Hey, that's kind of cool. Where'd you get it?" And the frog says, "Buenos Aires." See where this is heading? Yes, sir.
You discussed his external persona and his leadership skills more externally. The College of Cardinals, incredibly conservative. He may have another decade, given his age. Is he going to get the College of Cardinals to follow his three mission, or are they just going to wait him out?
Well, I mean, I take the point of your question, although I'm going to have to dissent from it slightly, in this sense that... these terms, liberal and conservative, first of all, these are artifacts of Western culture. I mean, they come out of the French Revolution, right? The left wing and the right wing of the assembly after the revolution. People from other parts of the world, up to and including cardinals, up to and including, by the way, Pope Francis, don't always naturally and organically think in these categories. I mean, you know, you may have noticed that it has been extraordinarily difficult for the American media to nail down whether this pope is a liberal or a conservative. Well, part of the reason for that is because these are our categories, not his. Okay, and I would say that that's, I mean, you asked me, if you ran down this stairway right now, okay, and wrestled me to the ground, and said, the new cardinal from Tonga that was elevated in the last consistory, that I spent 2 hours interviewing, is that guy a liberal or a conservative? You would have to choke me to death, because I would have no way of meaningfully answering that question. Okay, so I don't think the College of Cardinals is to analyze it as this pope is liberal and the college is conservative. I think that often conceals more than it reveals. That said, it is true that Francis is taking a different approach on some questions. I mean, and it is also true that to bring the rest of the church along with him, he's going to have to make some personnel moves. He's done that in the Vatican. He has begun doing it with particularly important bishops' appointments around the world. Certainly I can tell you for sure that the new archbishops who have been appointed on his watch for Cologne, Madrid, Sydney, and Chicago were all very personal picks by Francis outside the usual channels. I mean, his fingerprints were all over those nominations. So I think he is slowly chipping away at that. But, you know, your question is, how long will it take for him to completely bring the senior level of the church around with him? Infinity and a day, ladies and gentlemen. I mean, John Paul was pope for 27 years, and he did not completely bring the senior levels of the church to think the way he did. Francis is the 266th pope, and he is the 266th pope who has had some difficulties with his bishops. Okay, it's just built into the DNA of the church. We are way too big and way too complicated to ever move uniformly in a single direction at any one time. So I think the honest answer is, the longer Francis is around, and the more that membership in the college are his appointments, the more it will come to resemble his way of seeing things. If you are expecting that we are going to lurch from, you know, one position pre-Francis all the way 180 degrees to a second position post-Francis, Catholicism just doesn't work like that. You know, never has, never will.
When the Pope comes to the United States, what do you think his central message is going to be? And if there's going to be a surprise signature place for him to visit, what do you think that will be?
Well, you know, you mentioned surprise. I was telling some people at dinner tonight, if there's one thing I've learned about covering Pope Francis for 2 years, is that this Pope ought to come with a warning label like a pack of cigarettes that reads, "Caution, predictions are hazardous to your health." Okay, because if anybody here feels they are confident about what he's going to do on anything at any given time, I'd like to know how. So that said, I do anticipate some sort of surprise. All of his foreign trips have had some kind of surprise. It's become part of his modus operandi. I mean, for example, we were recently with the Holy Father in Sri Lanka and the Philippines in January. Okay. It was the second day we were in Sri Lanka. He had an event that had run about a half hour early. Okay, that had finished about a half hour before it was supposed to. Now, any other normal person, okay, at that moment would have said, all right, you know, we would just call it a day, because it was like 8:30 at night, okay? But Francis, no, I've got a half hour that's unoccupied. You know, let's do something. And so what he decided he wanted to do was he wanted to have a meeting with the bishops of Sri Lanka, because he was supposed to have one the day before, but it had to be canceled because the crowds when he landed were so much bigger that a trip into town that was supposed to take him 20 minutes had taken an hour and 40 minutes. Part of the reason is that Sri Lankans had turned out a delegation of 60 ceremonial elephants, okay, to accompany him. And elephants lumber, they don't sprint, all right? Somebody, whoever the advance team is, kind of came, but they should have figured that out, right? But anyway, he decided that, okay, I had to scrub that meeting yesterday, let's go. And so he got in the papal limo and had them take him to the archbishop's residence, which is where he figured the bishops were going to be. It's just, they were still stuck at the airport because he had been up in the north of the country that day. So he gets to the archbishop's residence. They're like, Holy Father, we're really embarrassed, but the bishops aren't going to be here for another 20 or 30 minutes. He said, that's all right. When we were at the airport yesterday, I met this Buddhist monk who invited me to visit his temple. So let's go there. And so they did. So he gets on the, you know, totally unscripted. You know, they do this drop-by. It's only the second time, by the way, a pope had ever entered a Buddhist place of worship. And he does this encounter with the monk and then insists on going back to the archbishop's residence to go ahead and have the meeting with the bishops that night. My point is that every time this guy goes on the road, it's a roll of the dice. So something unexpected will pop up in the States. Quite what it will be, I don't know. You asked, what will his main message be? Well, I mean, you know, popes, when they travel, first of all, fundamentally, they will always say, and I think they mean it, that the fundamental purpose of every apostolic journey of a pope is to confirm the local church in the faith. Okay, so fundamentally, that's what he's going to be wanting to do in the United States, is confirm American Catholics in their Catholic faith. Now, that said, there clearly will be other items on the to-do list. I mean, bear in mind, he is going to Philadelphia for a Vatican-sponsored world meeting of families. Okay, so Catholic families from all around the world will be meeting there. And this is 1 month ahead of the pivotal Synod of Bishops on the Family in Rome in October, where he's, at the end of which, he's going to have to make some very difficult decisions, including what do we do about Catholics who have divorced and remarried civilly outside the church, whether or not, in some circumstances, they can be invited back to communion. Clearly, Philadelphia will be one of the places where he's going to be looking to gain insight into that question by talking to Catholic families and drawing on their experiences. We'll all clearly be listening carefully to every syllable he says in that subject for some hint of where he may be trending. In Washington, he's going to be speaking, first time a pope has ever done this, he will be speaking to a joint session of Congress, so that's the stop on the itinerary, where you would expect him to deliver his most developed social and political message. And there, I think it is clearly the centerpiece of that talk, as most of this pope's social rhetoric is, will be about the contrast between a throwaway culture and a culture of welcome, a culture of encounter, and what America needs to do to live up to its ambition or its historical promise of being a culture of welcome. Within that, I expect you'll hear him talk about immigration, the dignity of immigrants. I expect you will also hear him talk about the environment, because bear in mind, he will have, by that stage, released his new encyclical letter on the environment, which he is finishing right now, the first time a pope has ever devoted an entire encyclical to the environment. It's finishing this week, even as we speak, and it's supposed to appear in early summer, sometime mid-June. So it'll be out by the time he comes over, and he's putting it out in mid-June because he wants it out ahead of the UN Climate Change Summit in Paris in December. So clearly, he'll use the stage in the States to hammer away at that. New York, of course, he's speaking to the United Nations. So that message will not be specifically geared at the United States. It will be a kind of broader global message. Although, talk is, he's also going to play Yankee Stadium that afternoon. I'm thinking, you know, usually they set up when the Pope does Mass in Yankee Stadium, they usually put it basically where second base is. So I'm thinking maybe they can get Jeter to give him some fielding tips. You know? Although Tim Dolan, the Archbishop in New York, says that's not his use for Jeter. What he's going to use Jeter for that day is to take up a second collection to pay off the debt at St. Pat's. But whatever. Whatever. So we'll hear something from him directed to the American audience that afternoon. But the primary logic of New York is the global message. In terms of other stops he might make, you know, there had been a rumor that he might actually couple the trip to the States with the trip to Mexico and then make a stop at the border on his way between the two nations, given his commitment to immigrants. It would be a natural thing for him to do. I mean, he could go to Nogales, which, as I said, is the American Lampedusa, but he has ruled that out, saying logistically it just couldn't work, and he wants to do Mexico right. He doesn't want it to be an afterthought.
Again, thank you for being here.
Young man, yes.
What were your first impressions on the Pope when you first saw him?
First of all, great question. Thank you for being here tonight. You know, when I'm on the lecture circuit, I often hear all these complaints about how there aren't any young people in attendance. Well, ladies and gentlemen, echo the Catholic future, huh? You know, funny you should ask. The first time I met Jorge Mario Bergoglio, the man who is now Pope Francis, was in 2001. What had happened, there was a synod of bishops in the Vatican that began in September in 2001. And the guy who was supposed to be the relator, that is the kind of presiding official at that synod, was then Archbishop, later Cardinal Egan of New York. This synod was scheduled, as it happens, to begin 4 days after 9/11. Okay? Obviously, nobody knew that in advance, but that's the way it worked out. Now, Egan, who I know quite well and I like, but Egan had a reputation for just hating reporters, hating media. Okay? He hated doing interviews. I mean, if you walked up to him and said, you know, Cardinal, you will never have to talk to another reporter for the rest of your life, you know, I mean, he would be the happiest guy on the planet, right? But on this occasion, stepping outside of his own skin, he had agreed to give me an interview about the Senate, okay? Then 9/11 happens, okay? So 2 days later, he calls me, and he says, John, I'm sure you've probably already figured this out, but I'm not going to be able to stick around for the Senate. I have to go home to be with my people. Okay, so of course. So now the guy who is going to take over for me as relator is the Archbishop of Buenos Aires in Argentina. Now, he doesn't like doing interviews either. Okay, but I told him that I had made this arrangement with you, and he said that if you're interested, you know, he will sit down and talk to you. Now, you got to understand, I'm an American reporter overseas 2 days after 9/11. Okay, there's only one story we are doing, and it is not the Synod of Bishops. Okay, so honestly, I'm thinking this is going to be a complete waste of time. But then I think, well, maybe I can get him to say something like, we're all Americans now, or whatever, and, you know, there'll be a headline in it. So I said, plus I knew Egan was going out of his way to be gracious. Okay, so I said, sure, that's very kind, I'd be happy to see him. He says, all right, he'll be expecting you at the Santa Marta, which is the residence on Vatican grounds where visiting prelates stay, right? Said, he'll be expecting you at the Santa Marta, and whatever it was, you know, Wednesday at 9 o'clock. Now, I don't know if any of you in this room have ever been into the Dome of Santa Marta at the Vatican, but let me set the scene for you. It's they describe it as a hotel, but it's kind of misleading because there are people who live there on a full-time basis too, okay? I mean, so it's got guest quarters and also full-time, it's more of a residence. But it's quite luxurious isn't quite the word, but it's upscale, right? I mean, it's better than a residence suites, right? You know, and so you know, when you come to the front door, it's this sliding glass smoked door that opens, and then on either side there are these spiral staircases that take you down to the kind of reception area. So when you're going to meet a dignitary, okay, what you normally do is you go in those smoked glass doors, you go down one of the staircases, you go up to the desk, you say, I'm here, I'm so-and-so, I'm here to see His Eminence so-and-so. They call up to the guy's room, his flunky calls back down and says, oh, His Eminence is busy, you know, and then they put you into one of these waiting rooms and you cool your jets there for 10 or 15 minutes, and then the flunky comes down, and then maybe, if you're lucky, a half hour later, you know, the big fish kind of walks into the room. So there's this whole protocol to just intended, I think, to drive home to you where you stand in the scale of things. Okay. So that's what I was expecting. So on this occasion, I knew I was supposed to be meeting the Archbishop of Buenos Aires, Bergoglio. So I walk in, the smoked glass doors, and there's a guy just in simple clerical blacks sitting in a folding chair. Okay, it was never there. I mean, there's never anybody there. And so I'm kind of startled. He looks up at me and he says, "Le Allen, okay, are you Allen?" I'm looking for His Excellency the Archbishop. And he cuts me off. He's like, no, I'm Bergoglio. okay. And I says, where do you want to talk? He said, we could probably get another chair. And I'm like, man, you really don't know how this works, do you? Okay, because, you know, if you just go down there and tell them that you want a room, they're going to give you a room. I says, well, do we really? I said, well, Archbishop, just if we sit here, you know, people will be walking in and it might be awkward. So why don't we do that? So we get on, and I have to tell the guy at the desk that His Excellency would like to have one of the conference rooms. I'm like, oh, of course. So, you know, they have these guys, that, you know, these white coats, these, you know, with these little white bow ties that, you know, run you into the room, and they turn on the lights and all of that. And then, so we're there, and Bergoglio, who hasn't yet taken a seat, looks up at me and says, do you want something to drink? You know, maybe some coffee. I'm like, man, you really don't get it. Okay? I said, if you just tell those guys what you want, you know, they'll bring it to you on a silver platter. And he's like, oh, we don't need that. I'm like, okay, fine. And, you know, we proceeded to have this conversation. And honestly, you know, I have to say, looking back, it was not the most memorable interview I've done, you know, with a senior ecclesiastic over the years. We talked mostly about the Senate and mostly forgettable stuff. But I will say this, that when I saw those gestures from Francis in the first, like, 48 and 76 hours after his election, I knew that was real, okay, because I had seen it, you know, in full living color. So my first impression, young man, honestly, he wasn't Pope yet. Okay, my first impression, I'll be totally honest with you, was of a guy who was admirably humble and simple, and I worried a little bit outside of his political depth. Okay, that was my first gut level impression, that he didn't know how the game was played. It was only that I've seen him in action, I realized he was playing a completely different game. Okay, and his ambition was not to play the game as it always had been, but to change the game. Right? And I think he came into office with a game plan. And those of us who, you know, those of us on this beat who knew him much better than I did were telling me that, but it took a few months watching him in action to bring that home. Was that it? Are we done? Are you good? You got something? Great.
With such a considerable expectation, at least in the American church, for changes on teaching, you mentioned one flashpoint with the decisions on divorced Catholics. What other flashpoints do you think are coming forth, decisions the Pope has to make or unpack, and could the backlash be considerable? And second question is just, you know how popes communicate, but this one seems so different. What are the operational differences that he's communicating? Is he just on airplanes talking to magazines that he wouldn't ordinarily, popes don't talk to, or how is it different now?
Well, I'll answer the second one first. Operationally, how is his communication style different? He's his own PR war room. I mean, you know, there's a staff of people who were paid to do communications on behalf of the Pope. They normally learn about stuff the same way you and I do, okay? Which is some Twitter flash that, you know, the Pope just said this, you know? I mean, his poor spokespiece, I know the people, they're all friends of mine, okay? The people who were paid, you know, to be his portavoce, his spokespersons. I mean, you know, talk about people who wake up in the middle of the night in a cold sweat, okay? Just like panicking. Now, of course, that has to be measured with the fact that fundamentally it's all good. I mean, you know, the Pope, without in any sense minimizing the fact that there is some ambivalence about him in some quarters. You know, fundamentally, at least for the outside world, he plays astonishingly well. You know, even his controversies get spun up into something cute, right? Like this thing about breeding like rabbits. You know, I mean, it drove some people crazy internally, but externally it was like, isn't it so cute the Pope uses language like that? You know what I mean? I mean, this is the difference, you know, in narrative, the difference in PR, okay? In the Benedict years, people assumed everything they didn't like about the Catholic Church was because of the Pope. Now they assume everything they don't like about the Catholic Church is in spite of the Pope, right? And so he gets an enormous PR bump because of that. So his spokespeople are kind of riding that wave, but still, it drives him nuts, okay? He's very spontaneous. I think... And I think, you know, a day is going to come in which a conversation is going to have to be held about whether that spontaneity is always an unmixed blessing. Because I think there are times when he has said, just off the cuff, as a pastor reacting in the moment, you know, things that have had some fairly negative consequences. I mean, I give you a recent example. He recently described the conflict in Ukraine as a fratricide, okay, as a war among brothers. Okay, and this was his pastor's heart, you know, not wanting to see people at one another's throats. You ask most Ukrainians, however, and they will tell you this is not a goddamn patricide. This is a foreign aggression by Russia. Okay, and until we call it what it is, you know, the situation is not going to get resolved. Okay, so some of that let it all hang out style of his, you know, I think there are some bumps in the road. Okay, but fundamentally, having watched him in action for 2 years, I think, you know, what you see is what you are going to continue to get. Okay, this is a pope who was just determined not to live in a bubble, okay, and not to be managed, not to be handled, you know. And I'm sorry, the first part of that was?
About the expectation for changes in teaching.
Oh,
the reaction.
Listen, I mean, if you by that you mean doctrinal change, folks, if there's one thing that hasn't already become clear about Francis, let's make it clear, crystal clear right now. This is not a doctrinal radical, okay? This is not Che Guevara in a cassock, okay? Francis has been in office for 2 years, wielding what the Code of Canon Law in Canon 313 describes as full, supreme, ordinary, and universal jurisdiction in the church, which basically means he can do whatever he wants, okay? And he has not so much as changed a single comma in the Catechism of the Catholic Church. So if the expectation is that there are going to be radical breakthroughs in terms of church teaching, I don't think that's the case. I think that's a false hope. However, those of us who move in the church, we know the distinction between doctrine and the pastoral application of doctrine, right? These are two different things, related but distinct, okay? Let me give you a concrete example just in case that sounds fuzzy or abstract. Okay, we have a teaching on marriage, and our teaching on marriage is that marriage is between one man and one woman. It's a permanent union open to life. Okay, that teaching is not going to change under Pope Francis. Now the question is, how do we apply that teaching? Okay, let me give you a concrete decision that the Catholic institutions around the world have to make. Catholic school. It is quite likely that certainly in the West, this is true of the Catholic school I taught in the early 90s. I think it's probably true of most Catholic schools in most parts of the West these days, that some small component of your student body may come from same-sex parent households. Okay, it's a plain fact. Okay, now the question is, how do you approach those parents in terms of integrating them into the life of the school? Okay, do you quietly pull them aside and say, listen, your children are very welcome here, we treasure them, they're parts of our community, but when we do school events, and particularly school masses and so forth, it would probably be best if you didn't come because we don't want to create scandal and we don't want to create confusion about what we stand for. Another option would be to say, we are delighted that your children are here, we want you to feel included in the life of this school, and so when we have parents meetings or we have masses or whatever, you know, within the limits of what your situation is, you know, we want you to participate. We want you to be there. On the theory that some contact with the faith is better than none and that this is a kind of evangelical moment. Now, both of those instincts, catch the point, both of those instincts are fully consistent with the teaching. But at a pastoral level, they create a kind of different vibe, okay, about what that place is about, right? I think in that's the sense where the Francis, if there's a Francis revolution going on, it's a revolution in pastoral application, not in doctrine, okay? It's trying to push the church within the limits of fidelity to its teaching and fidelity to its tradition, within those limits, which are not in question, okay? Within that, then those are clear markers. Boundaries, if you like, but within those boundaries, trying to push the church to the most generous, compassionate, merciful form of pastoral application possible. You ask, where are the flashpoints? Well, if we look at this Synod of Bishops in October, I would say there are clearly three. Okay, one is the question of divorced and remarried Catholics and whether, under some circumstances, on a case-by-case basis, they could be invited back into reception of the sacraments. Second, how positive can we be in our moral evaluation of same-sex unions? That was one of the strong flashpoints last October, and it will be again. You know, some bishops believe that we can say about same-sex relationships, that even though they're not the Christian ideal of marriage, that nevertheless they contain some positive elements that we ought to be able to acknowledge. Others would say, no, human beings contain positive elements, but these relationships are intrinsically disordered, and we can't acknowledge any moral value to that relationship. Okay, that's going to be a flashpoint. And third flashpoint is, what about people who are living together in all sorts of other ways, you know, that don't cohere with the full Catholic ideal of marriage? I mean, you know, cohabitation, right? Living together outside of marriage, right? How pastorally welcoming do we want to be of those life situations? Balancing the risk of scandal and confusion against the desire to get out of the sacristy and into the streets, right? Those were the flashpoints last October. They will be the flashpoints again this October. I think you may see forward movement in all three of those areas from Francis, but catch the point. It's going to be a forward movement, not in doctrine, but in application of doctrine. Okay. Do we have time, or?
Two last questions.
Great.
Thank you for your kind comments about Archbishop Gregory. Two related questions. What are your thoughts about the possibility that Atlanta will be the seat of a cardinal someday? And secondly, do you think there's a possibility that the Pope could name Wilton Gregory as cardinal?
Well, I can answer the second question much easier, because if Atlanta becomes a red hat sea, then by definition, Wilton Gregory becomes a cardinal. Here's what I would say. I think it is possible. I mean, I think, frankly, the truth of it is that even before Francis, okay, you could look around the Catholic map in the United States, and you could say that there are some places that traditionally have been red hat dioceses that the logic just isn't there anymore. Baltimore, St. Louis, Detroit. I mean, given the declining Catholic populations, the exploding Catholic population in the South and the Southwest and so on, you know, the browning of American Catholicism, the fact that 33% of those 67 million Catholics in the United States today are Hispanic, and by mid-century that's going to be 50%. In other words, we're going to reach a tipping point in which white Anglo-Catholics are actually a minority in the United States. I mean, given all of that, okay, I think you could make a good argument for places such as Atlanta, even places such as, you know, Miami in the South. In the Southwest, they already created one new red hat sea in Galveston, Houston. You know, you could make a really good argument that Dallas ought to blow past being an archdiocese and move directly to being a red hat sea if you just look at the population numbers. I mean, you know, the Catholic population of Dallas 10 years ago was 200,000. Today it's 1.2 million. I mean, it's astonishing. Astonishing. So that was already there before Francis came along, okay? And I think the natural trajectory of things would have been you know, at some future point, either the guy in Miami or the guy in Atlanta or the guy in Dallas would get lifted up. Now, the calculus, however, is fundamentally different with Francis for the following three reasons, okay? One, Francis, as the first pope from the developing world, is profoundly conscious of the global dimension of Catholicism, and he wants the top of the church to look a little bit more like the bottom of the church. I mean, you know, look at this last consistory he just had in February when he created 20 new cardinals. By the way, that is the appropriate ecclesiastical verb. Do you all know that? That a pope creates a cardinal? Which leads to the cynical old Roman joke that only God and the pope can make something out of nothing. But anyway, you look at that cast of characters. The Pope created 20 new cardinals, 15 of whom are under 80 and therefore eligible to participate in a conclave. Of those 15, there was only one Vatican official, only five from the West. The rest came from a staggering variety of places. I mean, I mentioned Tonga. To be honest with you, ladies and gentlemen, I didn't even know that Tonga was a country until it got a cardinal. And I certainly didn't know it had a king and queen, but I've now met them. Lovely people. 100,000 people in Tonga. It's like Cedar Rapids, Iowa, but they have a monarchy. It's magnificent. And, you know, Panama and New Zealand and Myanmar and, you know, all of these corners of the map. Point there, I don't think in the first instance, I don't think Francis is anxious right now to create a lot of new American cardinals. Okay, I think he recognizes that we are 6% of the global Catholic population, but we are 11% of the College of Cardinals. Right? And so I think in the short run, you're just not going to see a lot of new American cardinals, which is not an indictment of any one of these guys. It's not to say he doesn't like, you know, Wilton in Atlanta or Jose Gomez in LA. I mean, I think all things being equal, he would love to be the Pope who named the first Latino cardinal in the United States. But I think in the interest of equity, right now, he believes that the American church is overrepresented. Bear in mind, we're the second largest national bloc in the College of Cardinals after the Italians. Okay, and I think his drive is to spread the wealth someplace else. Okay, secondly, he also, and I think this is his real innovation when it comes to cardinals, he is trying to break the clerical ladder in the church that says that if you get a big time archdiocese, you are automatically entitled to becoming a cardinal. Okay, he doesn't want it to be an entitlement. He doesn't want it to be a clerical badge of office. And you see that, for example, like for instance, last consistory a year ago, he lifted up the first ever cardinal from Haiti. But notice he did not name the Archbishop of Port-au-Prince, which would be the traditional dominant archdiocese in Haiti. He named the bishop of a small, impoverished rural diocese in the south, who also happened to be the president of the Haitian Bishops Conference. Okay. This time around, yes, he created two new cardinals from Italy, but for the second time, he bypassed Venice and Turin, which are traditional red hat archdioceses, right? And he named a new cardinal in rural Sicily, and he named the guy who had welcomed him in Lampedusa. Okay, so these were symbolic appointments intended to lift up a particular personality because of what they represented, not as a reward for having successfully moved your way up the clerical ladder. So I think the logic that says that because a place like Atlanta is an expanding and dynamic and growing archdiocese, and it is now actually larger than many of the other places in the states that have traditionally had cardinals, okay, in the world that I grew up in, that would have meant that Atlanta should get a cardinal. Okay, in the world of the church in the Francis era, to be honest with you, I'm not sure what it means anymore. Okay, so that's all by way of saying I think it is entirely plausible. I mean, certainly if the Holy Father were going to go looking for some new place in the United States to award a cardinal's red hat, obviously Atlanta would have to be in the radar screen. Okay, and I certainly think that in the abstract, Wilton Gregory is the kind of guy who he'd like to affirm. Okay, but that said, I just don't want to raise your expectations artificially about how quickly this is going to happen, because I would say that my reading is that we're not going to get new American cardinals quickly, and when we do, they're going to be in unusual places.
Thank you.
Yeah. Yes, sir.
Mr. Allen, I have a two-part question. Number one, the three themes of your talk here tonight on reforming and so forth, do you think the Pope has an affinity for one over the other? Number two, your relationship with Kansas University. I used to watch the KU Jayhawks.
Rock Chalk Jayhawk, baby.
Just decimate everybody else in the league in the Middle West. And your relationship to that, if by any chance, does it also engage Fog Allen?
As a reporter, all I can say is that there are 13 consecutive years of Big 12 championships does happen to coincide with the 13 years I've been an alumnus of the University of Kansas. You know, draw your own conclusion, sir, but you know, as the old saying from West Point goes, once is an accident, twice is coincidence, three is enemy action. This is enemy action, is what I'm saying. Of the three pillars, okay, that is leadership as service, the missionary conception as church, and mercy as the core Christian message right now, you're asking, is there one of those that is more precious or foundational or important to Francis than the other? No, except that he has not described his papacy as a kairos of service, and he has not described his papacy as a kairos of mission, as profoundly committed as he is to those two things. He has described his papacy as a kairos of mercy. I don't think that's accidental. I don't think his choice of motto is accidental. I don't think his rhetoric about mercy is accidental. Now, I mean, to be clear, you know, he gave that remarkable speech at the close of the Synod last October, which had been marked by this sharp clash and at times kind of nasty internal infighting and so on. And he gave that speech, which was intended to be a kind of unifying speech at the end. And we said we have to avoid the twin dangers of what he called a hostile rigidity and a false mercy, kind of a fake mercy. And so, it's not, to use the Bonhoeffer language, he's not about cheap grace, okay, or cheap sense of mercy. But nevertheless, that kind of adult sense of mercy that includes within it the capacity for judgment, includes within it the capacity to call sin by its own name, includes within it the strong commitment to the church's traditional discipline, when it comes to matters of the spirit, given all of that. Okay, I would say that if you're looking for one cornerstone above all, one word to try to understand what this pope is about, I would give you mercy. I think that's how he understands it, and that's what he wants his legacy to be. Okay. Listen, before they pull the plug, let me just say one last thing. Okay. I want this to be the beginning of a conversation among us and not the end. That is, I don't just want to parachute out of here and have no further contact with you. So let me make this offer to you. If I can ever be of use to someone in this room, I would be delighted to do that. Now, I honestly have no earthly idea what that might be. But, if you're in a graduate seminar at Emory someplace and some Vatican question or Pope question comes up you think I might be able to help on, or, you're in your parish and you need to do some Pope rumor control, or whatever it is. I mean, for God's sakes, ladies and gentlemen, if you're coming to Rome and you want restaurant recommendations, okay, this is where I truly shine. And yes, I am aware it's a real burden of my office that so much of it is done over lengthy Italian lunches and dinners, but I want you all to know I am over there carrying the cross for all of you. Okay. First time that line's ever gotten applause. These are fantastic people. Anyway, whatever it is, as you heard mentioned earlier tonight, I write for a website called Crux Now, CRUXnow.com. My articles are always on there. If you just click on anything I've written, my email address is at the bottom of those articles, and I do respond to that, by the way. Now, if you're going to try to contact me that way, please do put like Aquinas Center or Emory or something in the subject line, so I don't think you're the eighth Nigerian prince today who's going to give me 30 million bucks if I just turn over my credit card details or whatever it is. But assuming you permeate my spam filter, I would be delighted to help you. I mean, I run around talking a pretty good game about the need for the church to come together and to try to overcome these tribal animosities we sometimes succumb to. But if that's going to mean anything, obviously I need to walk my own talk. So, the point is, if I can help you, it wouldn't be an imposition. It would be a chance for me to feel like a person of integrity. So please take advantage of it. Again, thank you. God bless you.